Welcome to worship with the Universalist Unitarian Church of Peoria. My name is Reverend Jennifer Innis. It is my great joy to be the minister with this congregation of all seasons and all times of life. We are a beloved community striving to live into its mission of embracing freedom, loving wholeheartedly, growing in mind, body, and spirit, and adding to the wholeness and the healing of the world. We advocate for human rights. We strive to be good stewards of this earth. We welcome people of all races and ethnicities, sexual orientation, gender identities, social and economic situations, politics and abilities. And we recognize the deep network of which we are a part. For this, as we take a moment in our service, as we have been asked to do, we take a moment to recognize the Peoria people, for this is their ancestral home. They were here long before the first European settlers came down the Illinois River. And so we take a moment in service to recognize the Peoria people for who they were and for who they are today. I want to welcome folks to join us in person and online. It is good to be together. If you are new to us, whether a first time or a first few times, thank you for joining us. Please ask all the questions. Please let me encourage everybody to wear name tags so that we can get to know each other better. For this, we know that one of the greatest gifts is that we are in relationship, that we acknowledge each other's presence. So let's do that today. I want to invite folks to stay after the service for coffee in Fellowship Hall if you're joining us in person, or for a brief chat online if you're on Zoom. And in this moment, I want to invite us to turn our respective devices to worship mode. All the devices, we have so many these days. Take a personal check. What devices do you have on today? Because, boy, they add up. And I have a few notes today about some of the things that are happening. One, that after the service today, about noon or so in the conference room, is coffee with the minister. This is a chance to kind of have a smaller conversation, to get to know each other a little bit, ask me all kinds of questions. We'll talk about the church as well. Regina Stanley is our good contact for that as well, our membership coordinator. So I invite you to go grab a drink, maybe a snack in Fellowship Hall. Come join us in the conference room. Oh, and we also have our own snacks too. So, you know, come on over. Let's see. So we have a number of things coming up. This next weekend, Friday evening, because the annual campaign theme is the church that says yes, we are having a Yes Day movie night. And that is Friday, this coming Friday the 12th, and all ages are welcome to join us for the Yes Day movie showing. On Saturday, April 13th, we have a spring cleaning opportunity with options for indoors and outdoors tasks. So if you come to see the slide, come join us for about 9 or so on Saturday morning. We have a window of time. We'll have a range of tasks that folks can do. Come and join us, do something, do a lot of things. Really, a little bit goes a long way. Also, Saturday morning, Jesse Lachlan and Bill Ordaz will be leading the next installment of our Date with Death program. The topic will focus on hospice, palliative care, and also getting some of the documents in order. And after service next Sunday, after service on the 14th, we are proud to be able to host Jolt Harm Reduction, or they're having a clinic for some testing, for counseling, for resources. So this is, Jolt is trying to serve a wider range of people in the Peoria area, and we are happy to be part of that effort. I also want to just point out, we just had the newsletter come out. There are so many ways to grow and serve and get connected. So see the order of service or see the newsletter for all the announcements. And I want to, at this point, invite Linda Fairbanks, the president of the board, up for a message about our annual campaign.
Good morning, everybody. Do we have any Father Brown fans here? Raise your hand. Father Brown? Anybody? I'm a huge Father Brown fan. Since I don't see too many here, I'll tell you, it's an Agatha Christie-like series on BritBox in a fictional English village called Kembleford. And Father Brown is the detective in this Agatha Christie-like movie or series. So I love this fictional world, Kembleford. The only thing you need to worry about is getting murdered. Anyway, I'm watching the series. There's 12 seasons. There's all these shows. And I'm watching the series, and a character shows up who is missing part of their arm. What's the story here? Turns out they are just another character, and the fact that they are missing part of their arm isn't even relevant. Then it happens again and again. In the history of drama TV, I expect melodramatic backstory, focusing on that person and their struggles. Why was I so distracted by this lack of a backstory? Well, it took a minute for me to process what I was experiencing. In this depiction, people like me weren't being treated as other or different. They were depicted just going about their lives, having a profession, being in a relationship, having a family. They weren't other. What I was experiencing was representation. People being seen as a whole person rather than whatever physical or mental characteristic seems to set them apart. So what does the story have to do with the annual campaign in our church? Being seen as a whole person, this is how I feel when I am in this community, and I hope all of you do as well. This is how we live our very first principle. We respect the inherent worth and dignity of every person. We aren't perfect at it, but we strive for it. And this church is visibly working in the wider world to strive for that principle as we support trans rights and the LGBTQ community, our work with the Faith Coalition for Racial Equity, Black Lives Matter, and more. This is why I choose this church. This is why we pledge. Every year, we consider whether our pledge and whether we might want to give a little bit more than last year, and we usually do. Please consider your pledge for the church, and if you can, give a little more than last year. We have so far received 56 pledges totaling $186,118. We are at 52% of our goal. Thank you to each and every one of you who has already pledged. If you haven't pledged, please do so. And remember that any new or reinstated pledges are matched dollar for dollar. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. I appreciate that note about how we all can participate as well. If you're not familiar with how pledging works in a congregation, this congregation relies on pledging for the majority of its fundraising, for making happen, for financing all the good stuff that's going to be in the year to come. If you want to know more about how the church finances work as well, we're happy to have that conversation too. Linda can, I can. Any number of folks in the congregation can. So I just want to encourage folks to feel free to wonder and ask questions. We might even talk a little bit about that during coffee with the minister as well. All right. Now, would you please rise in body or spirit and join me for our opening hymn number 67 in the gray hymnal, if you like the music. We sing now together. Thank you. I invite Mary Mahalan Kafar forward for our opening.
Our opening words today are "We Are One" by Reverend Carol Thomas Cecil. We are one, we are family, we are connected by blood and bone, mind and heart, and sometimes bricks and mortar, like the finest woven tapestries of old and species blended and stirred into our family's secret recipes. Our lives are intentionally intertwined, and we are fashioned into a stronger community by those connections. This interlacing, intertwining, intermingling of our existence makes each of us whole. This interlacing of our lives makes us whole, happiness and sorrow. The intertwining of our lives makes us whole, blessings and burdens. The intermingling of our life makes us whole, lament and laughter. May we allow the magic and the mystery, often named spirit, to keep us connected long after today's service is ended. Come, let us worship together this morning.
Let me invite Bill and Isaac Ordaz for our chalice lighting.
For the Web of Life by Paul Sprecher. We light this chalice for the web of life which sustains us, for the sacred circle of which we have our being, for the earth, the sky, above and below, and for our Mother Earth, and for the mystery.
So I want to invite folks to enjoy and listen to, and maybe even participate in our special music for today. I want to invite us to listen to Natasha Greene and her friends. They are singing the piece Home, which was part of our prelude as well, if you came in during that. They invite us to listen to and even sing with them and just kind of hum along, if you want. The words will be up on the screen as well. This is a kind of circle singing in, well, a pew format, but circle singing in that spirit. So we are invited to sing if we are moved, explore sounds and harmonies that rise. This is for connection and joy.
Thank you.
I invite us into a moment. We've received the gift of music. We're going to enter into a little bit more of a gift of music. Invite us into this time for reflection. We gather and invite all who are with us to come forward and light candles during this time. The act of lighting the candle among us is a way to be intentional and deliberate about bringing a spark into the world. That might be for joy, it might be for sorrow, it might be simply in honoring the existence of something in your mind and on your heart. If you're online, these lights are welcome to be yours as well. Let us enter into our music for meditation. Thank you. We enter into a time of shared joys and sorrows with a note about the eclipse from Michael Mead, mythologist and storyteller. At totality, the sun appears as it truly is, a star amongst the other stars. At totality, it looks more like a living, breathing thing than a bright, solid orb. This unusual sight can be a reinforcement of the now common idea that we are each but a mere speck of rock drifting around the sun. Or it can be a revelation that reassures our souls that we are secretly connected to the whole living cosmos. The hundreds of millions of people who feel instinctively driven to observe this rare heavenly event are not acting out of simple curiosity, but are, knowingly or not, being drawn to the underlying sense that we are connected to the heavens, that we are interconnected with the cosmos itself. Tomorrow is the great solar eclipse that runs across the world, including the United States. I know I'm looking forward to putting on my glasses and enjoying what I hope is reasonably beautiful weather as the event unfolds this close, but not quite to totality. That's okay. May all who are traveling for this amazing event be safe and well. So I want to share a joy that Jesse Lachlan, our Director of Lifespan Religious Education, brought three of our teenagers, high school teenagers, on a road trip to Columbia, Missouri this weekend. They were participating as part of a youth conference at our sibling UU congregation there. And yes, it included sleeping on the floor. Ah, the memories of my youth and sleeping on the floors of many UU congregations. There we go. And they have confirmed that they are on their way home. I hope they had a really good time. I really want to thank Jesse for being the advisor, too. Let me move to wishes for health. Donna Dalrymple asks for healing thoughts as she recovers from her recent hospital stay. And now I turn to remembrance. I offer an invitation for tomorrow, 10:30 in the morning here. Out on the patio, I think, for remembering Karen Folster. Members and friends are welcome to join us as we spread her ashes on the church grounds and share a few memories on the patio. That's tomorrow, Monday at 10:30. I also want to offer a note how lovely it was to see a few members and to enjoy the celebration of life for Lori Russell Chapin on Friday at the Davison Fulton Woolsey Wilton Funeral Home. In our wider world, our hearts go out to the aid workers killed during an Israeli strike in Gaza. This terrible loss is one of the most recent in the 6 months of conflict between Israel and Hamas. We are at the 6 month anniversary of October 7th, when so many were killed and harmed and taken hostage by Hamas in Israel. And in the months since, Israel's attacks have left over 32,000 dead in Gaza, plus destroyed the infrastructure of the community and cut off access to food and water and medical care. So many have worked for peace since Israel was established, and so many expect more from their current leaders. As Unitarian Universalists, we call for humanitarian aid, the return of hostages, and work toward a ceasefire. And we speak out against the rising Islamophobia and anti-Semitism that is even showing up here in Peoria, but certainly is also in our country and in the world. I invite us into a moment of quiet. for all who are caught up in this terrible conflict, for all that is with us and within us, for the struggles in our world in this moment. Let us pause. Let us pause in the quiet together. Shalom, salam, amen. I invite Holly Greenford for our story today.
Jessie asked me to read this in her absence, and I'm absolutely delighted to do so. This book is called Everything is Connected by Jason Gruhl, illustrated by Agnasi Font. I love that the illustrator's last name is Font. Love it. But this book is amazing, and I read it, and I'm like, oh yeah, I'll do this. Okay. Everything is connected, and since you are part of everything, you are connected to everything. You're connected to a human body, to hands and eyeballs, and teeth, toes, elbows, a butt, and even a nose, to a heart and some lungs and a strange-looking stomach, and a brain that is so smart, there's no peak it can't summit. But you're not just a body. You're bigger than that. You're connected to people, to everybody, to moms and dads, to sisters and brothers, uncles and cousins, grandfathers and grandmothers. You're connected to friends and to teachers at school, and even people you don't think are cool. You're connected to people in Denver and Maine, in Paris and Baghdad, to strangers in Spain. You're connected to every human on Earth. Wow. And they are connected to you. You are also connected to hedgehogs and cats and dogs and squirrels and birds, rabbits and cows, and deer by the herds, monkeys, tarantulas, dolphins, and snakes. Friend, you're connected to every big, small, hairy, slimy, snuggly, scaly, floppy, flappy, bristly, beautiful creature on Earth, even blobfish. Blobfish, you say? Surely not that. They don't look like me. They don't talk like me or act like me, and they probably stink. But you see, we're connected. We all play a part in life. We're the same. We're all blobfish at heart. Now, this next part, though bonkers, is true, I'm afraid. You're connected to everything humans have made, to toys and to playgrounds, books and to chairs, gardens and medicine, language and prayers, buildings and bicycles, buses, balloons, hammers and paintbrushes, tractors and spoons, but also to chicken pox, bullies and lies, to greed and pollution and trash piled high. You're not just connected to things that you like, things that are comfortable or easy or nice as a human. You're part of the everythingness. And sometimes it's scary and a big, ugly mess. But the good news, my dears, is that you are quite powerful, a force that's in everything, timeless and powerful. You're even connected to things you can't see, the invisible world, for at least you and me, to cells, DNA, diseases and death, amoebas and gravity, atoms and breath, to hydrogen, nitrogen, nanobots too. You're connected to them and they're connected to you. You're connected to happy, connected to sad, to the past and the future, to thoughts you have had, to pharaohs, Ben Franklin, T-Rex, ancient Greece, to love and to poverty, hunger and peace, to Jesus and Buddha, Muhammad and Moses, to spaceships and aliens with noses like hoses. You're connected to all that will be or has been. You're at this very moment where all things begin. For you are the sun and the moon and the stars, Venus and Jupiter, Neptune and Mars, comets and galaxies, voids and black holes. You are the universe, perfect and whole. Thank you.
I invite us to sing out the children and their respective adults to go to their programs at this point. Let us sing, Go Now in Peace. It is in the spirit of connection and recognition of the abundance that is among us that we receive an offering during the course of our service on Sunday. I want to invite us to join to express a practice of gratitude through a financial gift as we receive the collection, and yet again practice giving as an intentional, tangible act during service. And we also share a portion of our gifts through our Share the Plate practice. One-third of the undesignated offering goes to our monthly recipient. And now this month, since we are on the first Sunday, it is the Central Illinois Center for Blind and Visually Impaired. They provide programs and services for the emotional, educational, social, and cultural needs of those they serve. And right now, I caught their newsletter from March. Right now, they are working on improving their kitchen and their tech room and getting ready for a spring cleanup just as we are. So our Share the Plate will give a portion of our collected offering to Central Illinois Center for the Blind and Visually Impaired. I invite you to be generous, and thank you very much for the ushers for passing the plate. Author and strategist Adako Utah. They are a teacher, a healer, a community organizer from Nigeria. And they say, mycelium mushrooms have been one of my greatest teachers of trust. The word mycelium means more than one. Mycelium organism is a dynamic root system of mushrooms that utilizes trust as a mechanism to sustain and build a vast reciprocal underground network that connects the roots of the trees and plants and skillfully shares nutrients and resources to support the entire health of the ecosystem which it moves. This mycelial network cannot exist without trust. Mycelium communication, it's its own highway that recognizes and believes in its collective ability to channel and receive nutrients where needed, protect against parasites, and expand roots into necessary sites of growth. The network process also fosters intergenerational relationships that welcome a myriad of ancient wisdom and connections that reside in older trees to benefit younger trees. These mushrooms affirm a commitment to building relationships of trust that encourage all life to bloom. It is one that I aspire to embody more and more in my organizing practice. Here ends the reading. I invite us to enter into our hymn number 128, For All That Is Our Life. It is one that is new to the congregation. You've probably sung it in like the before times, sometime before the pandemic. This is one that we're going to be getting to know a little bit. And I asked Kathy to give it a little lift in the course of things. So we'll listen, and then I invite us to rise and sing. Seated. I want to begin by thanking folks who responded to my Friday Facebook request for thoughts about mushrooms. It's always fun to see what the collective mind can bring forth. Mushrooms, they spark joy as well as reverence and passion. They draw us into the woods, as one person said, and into our backyards. Especially at this time of year, I hear it is the time to gather morels, and where you find your morels is a closely guarded family secret. I'm in hearing. So I'm here. I want to offer a little bit of a confession, though, because I'm here. I really want to engage, do a little bit of a dive into mushrooms, mycelium, fungi, and the profound depth and mutual dependency at work in our world as much as we can fit into our time. And I will say that I am really new at engaging with mushrooms, about as new as one could be, so I'll show a little bit of my work and the process. And let me offer, I don't eat them. Nope, not if I can help it. You know, the green eggs and ham, not if I can help it. I have never cared for them. I will hardly try them. Please don't give me recipes or advice. Please don't. This is my task. I'm working on it. Because, well, I find them a little disconcerting, frankly. As Paul Stamets, who was featured in the Netflix show Fantastic Fungi, he provides some reasons why people have an interesting relationship with mushrooms. He points out that many are edible, many can hurt us, and many can kill us. Mushrooms often grow in dark, damp places on things that have fallen and died and need to decompose. So there's this association with death and icky. I mean, really, right? It is a little disconcerting to see mushrooms sprouting out from the corpse of an insect. I mean, it's a little weird. It's a little, it shakes a little bit of my mortality, you know, there but for the grace of God, right? Not yet, not yet. I also appreciate this beautiful cinematography of Fantastic Fungi. If you haven't seen it, I recommend it. And they offered examples of mushrooms cultivated in great lighting that really showed them to their advantage. I mean, they sold them really well. And they're funky. Fungi aren't plants and they aren't animals. They are their own kingdom, right alongside plants and animals and some bacteria. So I want to offer a couple of definitions. I certainly needed a little bit of help with this too. And a little bit, I will say, from the Gospel according to Wikipedia for the sake of expedience. A fungus, first, is any member of a group in organisms with a defined cell walls. And that includes microorganisms such as yeasts and molds, as well as the more familiar mushrooms. These organisms are classified with one of the traditional eukaryotic, that means you have your own cell wall, you know, this is my dance space kind of cell, along with animalia, plantae, and forms of bacteria, and the estimates in terms of the numbers of fungi is in the millions and millions and millions, and we have only identified a fraction. All right, so that's fungi. Then there's mycelium. It's the root-like structure of a fungus. So it's the root-like structure of the fungus that's about the mass of branching, thread-like hyphae. I'm getting a lot of Latin today. Hyphae. I love that. Its normal form is kind of like branched, slender, and tangled, thread-like. And the fungal colonies are composed of mycelium. They're found in and on soil and many other materials. They absorb nutrients from their environment and secrete enzymes that break down organic matter. And the mushroom is the fruiting body of mycelium. It is what we see, which is a mere portion of the whole organism. I think that's a little disconcerting by itself. I'm just going to say. But I think to talk about these wondrous forms, we need a little bit of imagery here. So if we can go to our first. So I really just want to talk about the typical toadstool. When you think of a mushroom, you think of the typical toadstool. Do we have that? Okay. There we go. So the typical toadstool, the red top. It's like umbrella-shaped and the white stalk and so on. So there's the typical toadstool with the bright red cap. And we know that mushrooms come in many, many forms. They certainly have little clusters like this, its own stalk and black and gray and blue and so on and many more. They're also simply stunning in their form. They are kind of architectural in this. Note the gills, the folds, the lines and the curve and shape, and have evolved to be in these shapes for whatever reason, because that has benefited its survival, and it simply is beautiful and keeps it together for as long as it needs to serve its purpose. It inspires our imaginations. And, as I said, they also are edible. This is the time of year, one of the times of year for the gathering of mushrooms, morels in particular. Those are the ones with the rough, deeply textured, asymmetrical honeycomb kind of cap. Somebody remind me which ones are these. Chanterelle, thank you. See, this is what I don't know. But I also want to offer, they're not just like growing in a bunch or growing in a stalk. They grow in a lot of different ways as well. And so the ones that I found in our neighborhood a little while ago is the better portion of a fairy ring. It was fascinating to watch this as we went on our daily walk as a family. I think it was kind of based in an old tree stump that probably was in the middle of it underground somewhere. And so every day, this ring would emerge, and it would be one day it would be one place, and the mushrooms would disintegrate, and then the next day it was another ring, the next, and it just kept getting wider and wider and wider. And what's also interesting, you could see that the grass around each ring and within the ring was getting greener and more robust than the rest of the grass as well. Finally, I want to offer that, as I've said before, most of the mushroom is not seen. Most of the mycelium is invisible to us. It is either not visible by being covered, or it simply is practically invisible to our sight. Most of the mycelium is underground with a network of fine, fine hairs and threads. This happens to be a little bit visible. This happens to be an oyster mushroom growing on coffee grounds. They grow on all kinds of things, right? Just want to recognize just a sample of the range in which we're talking. I do have a last vocabulary word to pick up on that last image with the delicate threads. Multiple organisms relating to each other in the mycelium like this is mycorrhiza, which is a symbiotic association between fungus and plant. It could be between a fungus and a tree, for example. The term mycorrhiza refers to the role of the funguses in the plant's system, in their relationship. They play a very important part of nutrition and soil and biology and chemistry, and it works in layers and layers of relationships, far, far more complex than even, say, the great world wide web, right? I love it. They've been calling it the wood wide web. I think it's fabulous because there's that too. In short, we need them. The earth needs all of these forms to break down organic materials, to convert them into fertile ground for new growth, to simply allow room for new life to take place. Animals and plants have evolved to depend on fungi. There is this mutuality. And it goes farther than we know. It goes farther than we know. We keep finding more frontiers of fungi, so to speak. There is even one that's becoming kind of like dark matter. It's now called dark fungi. It's in the same kind of family because we can only identify it by its DNA out in the field. And it can't be reproduced in the lab. It can only be found under its own native conditions. And there's not even a form. Like, I can't take a photo of it. You can only see it by its DNA. Experts don't even know how to classify it. And if they think the visible fungi is so profound in our world, the dark fungi has a massive invisible job to do. The world is so densely threaded, it is all around us. And it keeps moving. It doesn't move quickly, but it keeps moving. One of the gifts of that fantastic fungi show is the time-lapse photography that showed how flow and beauty and growth and diversity was showing up, as well as deconstruction amid the decomposition. How deep and profound this network was growing in relationship with trees, in conveying information and nutrients. It was the breath of life for the forest, chemical and electrical currents in many ways. I think it is for us just to be in awe of that which is around us that we can't begin to fully know. It is a gift, a profound gift, as we begin to explore the theme of interdependence, a reminder of all the connections, whether or not we know it. I appreciate that Adaku Utah talks about this, and her organizing strategy finds her inspiration in the mycelium networks for gathering and building trust, for communication when little is seen, as she says. It illuminates the distinct potential to generate meaningful communication, yield collaboration grounded in sustenance, bolster collective commitment, and acknowledge competence and worth. Acknowledge competence and worth, that every part of our system is whole and holy, just as we are. And to do so, and that this functions across generations and in crisis as well. And we feel it. We've been feeling it when that becomes absence, that depth of connection leaves us. We're kind of conducting a great social experiment for the last 40, 50 years or so, as folks have moved away from being active in church or religious community life. There's an article in The Atlantic, "The True Cost of the Church Going Bust" by Derek Thompson. And it summarizes what we've already known for some time, the decline in attendance at religious centers over the past several decades. The decline was showing up about 4 or 5 decades ago, and it's beginning to accelerate. It certainly accelerated with the pandemic. And it's not just about that people are less interested in church. That's not really the point. But the impact of the lack of ritual, habit, collective gathering, because that provides a source, that regular practice on Sundays, or whatever the day is of the gathering for whatever religious tradition, that how that provides a sense of regularity, a sense of schedule, a sense of purpose. And also very much connecting with people and saying, oh, you're human too, even though you're not necessarily my friend or my family or my coworker, you're this other person in my life. Because we're also seeing this in the same, at the same time as we're seeing the withdrawal from attending religious communities, we're also seeing a reduction in some of the civic engagement as well. And the author says he's not making a one-to-one, but it's an interesting, this is happening at the same time observation. Also coupled with the rise of individual screens that become the church just as well, right? Hi, how you doing? Yes? No. And the author is not asking for a return to belief or an immediate resumption of attendance. He's not going to do that. But he is wondering, and I am wondering, many of us are wondering what we have lost as a society when we're not regularly engaged with these other places in our lives, what missional conversations call third places in our lives that are not home and it's not school or work. It's this third place that keeps us engaged, that we regularly attend, that we meet and get to know people we might not meet anyplace else in our lives. If for no other reason, we have those additional connections, and that those mean something, even when we're not deeply, don't feel deeply connected, we are connected and are more able to see one another and say, hey, maybe we can do something together. We still need places of symbiotic relationships with people, people of all ages and places in life. We need diversity in our interdependence. I mean, there are millions of mushrooms for a reason. We need diversity even as we are deeply connected. We need places to gather and meet one another and to get to know, places in our lives for heartbreak and awe, for joy, for holding our fears. And they're not places only for what we can see, what we can perceive cognitively, but what we feel and sense and understand around us, whether or not we have words. And so we are gathered in this moment, thinking about mushrooms and all the gifts that they point to, the entirety of whole worlds that they call to us in recognition and awe, and how much it is worth for us to be thoughtful, intentional, present to the gifts and abundance that are around us. I want to close with one more moment from my colleague, Reverend Carol Sissel, from our opening words. Like the finest woven tapestries of old and spices blended and stirred into our family's secret recipes. Those could be mushrooms. I might try it. Our lives are intentionally intertwined. And we are made, no, we are fashioned into stronger community by those connections. This interlacing, intertwining, intermingling of our existence makes each of us whole. This interlacing of our lives makes us whole, happiness and sorrow. This interlacing of our lives makes us whole, blessings and burdens. This interlacing of our lives makes us whole, lament and laughter. May we allow magic and mystery, often named spirit, to keep us connected long after the service is finished. Let us allow magic and mystery and mushrooms into our lives. So may it be. I invite us to rise in body or spirit for our closing hymn number 1064, Blue Boat Home. It's in the teal hymnal.
We extinguish this flame, but we keep its light in our hearts with its message of love and justice, taking it outside these walls to the world we live in until we are together.
Reminded that we are part and participants of this universe, let us go forth from the quiet of this hour, encouraged to strive toward faithfulness to the best in ourselves and others and the whole mycelial creation. Our worship is ended. Let our service begin.